Blackstone Publishing presents The Body Myth, a novel by Rheea Mukherjee. This book is read by Suneela, Nankani.
Some might say there isn't anything beyond this physical world. Too late for you to see. This one's for you, Dad. I know you still see. 1. Take my story like you would a large pill. Place it on your tongue and swallow it in one gulp. I intend to write the truth. Truth is perspective, and I have been scrupulous with mine. The ego may occasionally sway me, persuade me to write lines that amplify my individual contribution. It might shelter you from certain details and obscure the things I am not proud of. But like most things, in good time, the truth always emerges. When I look back, I see myself as an Indian city on the verge of finding an identity. And then I lost control, expanded without direction, without a plan, becoming a vast series of interconnected roads, chaotic lanes, and fumes that left my body and mind exhausted. It's true. Every love story has been told. Every hidden kiss, every love letter, every heartbreak, accounted for and documented. It's been said. Mine is no exception, but like everything else, my version will exist as well. To get it right, I'll start at the beginning. Love stories, they deserve to be told. The way they bloomed, every little etch on the soul, every shift in the core, every fuck, like it was last night. Suryam, like most Indian cities, was hot in the summer and cooler in the winter, the rains unpredictable. We did have one thing that no other town, city, or village had, the Rasagura fruit. Pink on the outside, yellow on the inside, and speckled with tiny brown seeds, Rasagura thrived in Suryam's microclimate and no other. It was written about far too much, as its exoticization demanded. Its replication has been tried, of course, in the fertile soils of many other places, here in India and around the world, to unfortunate results. No, there was something in the soul of the city that made its way into the soil and extended to the rural outskirts, the end of the Rasagura's dominion. There was even a border sign, "Leaving the land of Rasagura." There was enough to share. Heaps of Rasagura were brought to market each day by the truckload, and other cities and towns bought the fruit at prices that would cover a fancy dinner. What does it taste like? Like a soaked berry, bursting with the tang of a lemon, with the texture of pudding and the sweetness of mango. The chief minister had tried to rename the city Rasagura in its honor, but it never came together. Still, the people of Suryam took credit, smiled proudly at relatives as they brought them baskets of the fruit. Dutifully, people from other cities said the same old thing again and again. Ah, how lucky you are to live where the Rasagura grows. We didn't feel lucky. It was, after all, an ordinary Indian city with weak infrastructure and a bunch of people in a hurry. We didn't think about the Rasagura all that much. Only when other people brought it up, or when we read another article with a new scientific theory for its hyper-local growth. Rasagura. The name could be seen in other places too. Pharmacies, gas stations, general stores, all named after a fruit. It was no different from any of our overused Hindu god names. Ganesh, Shiva, Lakshmi. And yet, once in a while, Rasagura succeeded in making us feel superior. The type of vicarious pride you feel when someone from your country wins, say, a Nobel Prize. Otherwise, the fruit is just there, and I'll try not to mention it too much. I digress just to find the right moment to start my story, and talking about the Rasagura, for some reason, helps. But the Rasagura certainly has nothing to do with it. No, My story starts with Sara. The first time I saw Sara. The woman was sitting on a park bench in West Point Gardens, where I came every Sunday for a 5-kilometer walk. She couldn't see me, but I had stopped mid-stride to stare at her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.